Good afternoon, everyone. I usually prefer to give my talks standing, but you may excuse me if I sit a bit today. So I'm going to talk about violins. And to introduce the talk, I think it's always nice to watch this little video.
Now, this is the ordinary inexpensive violin that I use just on my television shows. And this is a $30,000 Stradivarius that I use in my concerts. I want to show you why this is worth every dollar that I paid for it. Now first, listen to this cheap one. This is the cheap one. Just listen to it.
Commonly held beliefs about violins that circulate in the community of makers and players. The first one being that violins improve with playing. The longer and the better they are played, the more they improve. Any competent violinist can separate new violins from old simply by playing them. The best old Italian violins may seem quiet under the ear, but in a large hall will out-project seemingly louder new instruments. And it's quite common to hear things like, oh yes, with Stradivarius, the sound grows with distance, or gets bigger and bigger, you know, even if it defies science rules, but that's what they say. Stradivarius and Guarneri del Gesù violins are recognizable voices that can distinguish them from another and from their newer counterparts. And there is something about the sound of the best old Italian violins that has never been produced elsewhere or since. And then basically any maker or violinist would read this and say, yes, of course, that's the case. But is that really real? Is that believed or realities? And that had never been scientifically tested until the American violin maker Joseph Curtin contacted me saying, you know, we have all these beliefs, but I really start doubting about them and feeling that they are just beliefs and that circulate around the community, and people have been raised with it since their early childhood, and it may be time to really investigate. Especially that if we look at the literature, there were has been a few hundred years that violins has been studied by scientists and actually some makers as well, and there were always not really showing much difference, especially the studies from the 20th century, not much difference between old and new instruments. So we had to know whether it was because our tools to measure the mechanical properties were not fine enough and then we had to design new tools, or was it because actually there are not so much differences. So it was important for us as well to understand whether there was something in terms of perception or if it was more in the mind of the players and listeners. So that's how we started designing scientific blind experiments. There had been a few, actually quite many tests, informal tests. The first one we found was from 1880s or 1890s, which was reported. They all gave the same result, which was the new violins kind of win. But people were not believing in them because they were not really blindfolded, the audience was blind but not the player. It was often organized by your maker and then it was to promote his own making. So people didn't really believe in them. And so that's why it was interesting to do it properly. It was a scientific investigation. with some people like me having absolutely no interest whatsoever, so to kind of control all the parameters. So we did a first experiment in Indianapolis, which took place in September 2010, and then a second one in Paris, which took place in September 2012. Now we describe the different parts. So the Indianapolis experiment was basically the first go at it from our side. We gathered 6 violins, 3 new, 3 old Italians, among them 2 Strads and 1 Cremonese Gesù, with the other famous Cremonese maker, maybe less known from the general public, but as famous for violin players. We had 21 violinists, among which 19 professionals, and they were allocated an hour session in a hotel room. So to remove the influence of the vision, we reduced the light, and they were wearing goggles. So the fact is, like, if you put them completely blind, I mean, you've probably done the test yourself, you really wear something, you feel really strange. Your perception changes, we are not used to that, we kind of lose our balance, we really don't like it usually. So we didn't want to put them into this situation. And so these conditions was like dark enough for them to not see the visual aspects, the color of the varnish or little details, especially old instruments have often a little, something on the tailpiece, which is particular, or the pegs have something special. So we didn't want them to see that. At the same time, we wanted them to feel kind of comfortable in pain, and we didn't want them to drop the instruments as well. So they had to see the outline just enough to be kind of comfortable. So the experiment was divided into 2 parts, what we call the speed dating with pairwise comparison. So basically, they had to compare pairs of violins. These pairs were actually an old and a new one. They didn't know this, but. And then we had a more, I would say, ecological situation, which is they had basically the 6 violins aligned in front of them and had to choose the one they wanted to take home. So why to take home is because basically when violinists are looking for a new violin, they will go to different workshops, will try different violins, and if there is one or two that they like, they will usually ask the workshop, or can I borrow it for a few days or a week or two, depends. To actually try it in more, in other situations, then take it home to try it at home, but then as well to a concert hall or with friends in their quartet and their orchestra. So it's quite common for them to do this task. It doesn't imply that they would necessarily buy it, but it's something that they feel strong enough about to say, yeah, actually I would like to try it more. And considering the time they had, it was a reasonable question to ask. Of course, we can't ask them which one do they buy, because they would say, well, I need to see it and I need to know the price, things like this. Some people may find it short as well. So I've interviewed a few players, and it's quite common that some players really fell in love suddenly with the violin and actually bought it in 20 minutes, believe it or not. So when people say, yeah, it's too short, it's not necessarily too short for everyone. So the results showed that the most rejected during the pairwise comparison was a Stradivarius. And then for the one to take home, 13 players out of the 21 preferred a new violin. And at the end, just more as a question, was more an informal question, because we didn't want to focus on this, was, by the way, could you guess the age of the violin? And they didn't guess correctly. Why we didn't want to emphasize too much on this, players don't like to be wrong, so if you want them later of all the tests, or, you know, it's often nice not to have a question where is there is a right or wrong answer. So we usually try not to. We will do it in the second experiment because to some extent we have no choice, but we usually keep it to the end because that can already ruin the how they feel during the experiments. You really have, it's really important in psychology to have them feel comfortable and to understand that they are the experts. Otherwise they will just be nice, they will answer to the question because you ask them, but they will not necessarily do it the way they would behave in real situations. Of course, the community didn't like these results, so the study was vividly criticized. We basically got a K hit on internet, on forums, like, what have you done? How can you disrespect Stradivarius so much? And, people were really, really not happy, and then they found all different excuses to justify that the study was necessarily badly conducted. Starting with the fact that we definitely chose the bad Stradivarius, which for us was already a good move, because that means that now people were happy to acknowledge that there could be bad Stradivarius, so there was already something going forward. But the main critics was about the size of the room, because we did it in a hotel room. It was actually a deliberate choice for many reasons. The first reason is that violinists, when they try a new violin, they usually want to try it in a relatively dry room, because they want to listen to the violin and not to the room. And the bigger the room, the more reverberant it is, the more you hear the room coloration. And usually they don't like when a maker has a big workshop, because they say, oh, you get a great sound when you're there, and when you get out, you just have nothing left anymore. So that's what actually players like, to try as a first trial. I'm not saying that after they don't want to take it to a concert hall, but that's the question was, you know, to take home for further testing. So it really suited the question we wanted them to answer. The second reason was, though there were not so many, among the professional players, not all of them were soloists, but many of them were. And soloists, they tour a lot. So playing in a hotel room is something that they do every day, basically. So it's not an unsuitable place for them to actually play, and nobody ever mentioned, out of the 21, nobody mentioned that they couldn't judge in these conditions. And the last choice, of course, was a practical one. We were there for an international competition. It was easy to have the hotel room, because it was just a hotel room, and we didn't have to rent an extra space. So when you have limited money, that's a good reason too. So a French soloist called Hugues Barcelio contacted me. He was the only one who actually dared talking to me instead of just killing me on the internet. And he said, your study sucks, it was bullshit, you can't be in a hotel room, you know, it's like trying a Ferrari in a parking lot. You have to do it in a proper concert hall, and that's where you will see that Stradivarius violins have amazing qualities. And I was like, I'm really happy to do it, but I need some help, because I won't have the money to rent a concert hall. So if you help. So because he was a soloist, he's working with an agent who actually has a room, has a nice venue in Paris that he kind of uses to program concerts. And he said, you know, through my agent, we can probably have this hall for free for a couple of days. And because of the publicity of the first experiment, we were hoping to have more violins, and we thought, okay, let's go. So this is Hugues. So that's how we ended up doing Paris experiment. It took us 9 months, like a baby, to organize. Not actually work, harder work than making a baby, I have to say. Even less sleep in the afternoon. So we gathered 12 violins this time. We gathered more than this. We managed to get 9 old Italians and 50 new. And out of this group, we actually pre-selected by double-blind conditions what we found were the best 6 old and the best 6 new. I mean, obviously, that could be criticized, because what is best, it depends on the people. But we actually managed, there were a few of us, a few players and the team. We actually, there were big arguments about which one we chose. So. But one of them was a very beautiful one, and I remember the guy who gave it to us, who managed to get it for us, who was in the team, he came with it. I said, look at this amazing violin, and everybody was like shivering, it was beautiful. And then when we realized that we had rejected it, we realized it after, because it was in a blindfold, he cried. I said, can't be. But even himself had rejected it, you know, so that was part of the game. But it was an adventure, because we couldn't live without this 9 violin, so we basically having these 9 violins, which were about like 50 million, always with us, and carrying them. through the underground, so it was a bit of a quite a nice experience, a bit stressful, but you try not to think about insurance problems at that time. We decided to focus really on soloists for that, because the main critics are that, well, it's only really top soloists who can tell them apart. So we decided, instead of having many players, let's have less players but really top range players with international careers. We use the same protocol with dim lights, welding goggles, they use their own bow. I didn't mention that in the first experiment, but bow is always, you know, people say, yeah, but the bow makes such a difference. Yes, but the person who plays it makes a big difference too. So we just consider that the bow comes along with the player. So it's basically an extension of the arm. So yes, the bow will make a difference, but the player as well, and we just consider as a rule. And the one reason is because otherwise, which bow shall we choose for whom and for which violin, for example? And the second reason, and the most important reason, is like when violinists look for a new violin, they usually take their own bow because they don't want to have two things changing at the same time. And when they have found a new violin, then they will say, okay, now that I have a new violin, can I find a bow which fits better this violin? But they never do it together. This time we had 2 hours and 15 sessions. So the first one in a real room, and the second in a concert hall, to mimic the real situation where the person will choose among violins, and then he will take his favorite violins. In his case, it was all the violins, but he would take them to a concert hall and try them. We wanted to be really realistic as well. So in this in the concert hall, he could have 3 possible helps, which was he could come with a friend to give him feedback from the back of the hall. There was a pianist on stage, so he could try the violin with the pianist to see in particular whether the violin would go over the piano, because that's often a problem for sonata players, where they want a violin which will be strong enough to fight against the piano, which is a much bigger instrument. And they could as well go to the audience and then ask Hugues to play for them if they wanted to listen to the violin themselves from the audience part. We had asked them before the experiment, so we basically contacted many players. When they accepted, we asked them, okay, imagine this situation where you have to choose a violin, which help would you need? And they had to tick the different helps, and they all ticked the 3, and how long would you take? And they answered between 20 minutes and 2 hours. So we started having 2 sessions of 1 hour and 15, we were in the range of what they usually need. And I didn't say actually what was the exact question was to choose a violin for an upcoming tour. So because they are solids, we decided that this time we will go with another question than the previous one, but which is very, which could be usual for them, is they have a problem suddenly with their violin, they are going on tour, they can't have their violin and they have to choose. So there is a bit of time constraint in this, and they are used to. So that doesn't mean that they would choose this violin for good if they had to. They may have specific other constraints for choosing it for when it's just for the following week, but at least it's a question that makes sense for them and they are used to answer. So a few videos to give you the flavor of the experiment. I mean, obviously it was very, very dark, so you don't see much on the videos, but just enough to see what's happening. Russian-born, but living in America, soloist. And then you can see that the violins were displayed on the table, and what the light thing you see at the right is a screen, which was separating the stage from the audience. So in this part of the experiment, the audience was really, really small. Just a few people who were interested in watching and asked us if they could come the friend that they brought along, if they brought a friend. But just for this person, it was actually very important that the screen was separating the stage from the seats. And this is another soloist who won the Long Thibault international competition that year and who is using the piano. She's asking the friend to give her advice on what he had heard. I forgot to say that the piano excerpt were chosen with the soloist as well. It's their famous little part in the repertoire where they have to struggle against the piano, so it was a good excerpt to actually check this thing that they call kind of projection or going over the instrument. So the results. Basically, you have the violins here, F for new, O for old. Then the number was assigned arbitrarily from 1 to 12 to each violin. Because as they had to have advice, we had to give a number to each violin. So when they were talking with their friends, they could say, okay, what did you think of number 1? What did you think of number 5? Here we have the number of times they were projected. So I forgot to say that for the main task, to make it a bit simpler, because we know that 12 violins is a lot. Usually when players will go to a workshop, the maker will only present four or five violins. So 12 is a lot, but we knew at the same time that these soloists, they know exactly what they want. So basically they would already eliminate half of them just by playing them in a few seconds. And that's what indeed they did. So we asked them to reject the third that they already find unsuitable, and then among the rest, they should order their top 4. So these are the number of times they were immediately rejected, and above, you have the number of times they were chosen. So if the bigger is the block, that means that the higher the position was. So big white was first position, then second position, this is third position, and this is fourth position among their top 4. And as you can see, there is obviously a clear winner, which is a new one. But you can see as well that it was rejected twice straight away. So that's 2 players out of 12, out of 10, so that's still 20%. So you can see that the consensus among players is not, it's really that high. And then, depending if you consider, is it better to be chosen, you know, 3 times once or 1 times, but or more times, but among the 4. I don't want to go into this. There is no easy, correct, wrong answer, how you define. But probably kind of equivalent. And if we look, we basically have a preference of 3 against 2 for new violins. Which among 10 players could be easy 50-50, which is what basically we expected. People will like this violin because of that quality, and like another violin because of another quality, but not necessarily because it's all new. And then among the main objectives, you have two strides, a new. The more objectives we've never chosen, there is a stride and a new. So you can see that. It's kind of balanced. So this is about preference. And now about the question of, so this time we asked them to actually, among the top 4, which was their favorite, and if their favorite was new, we would choose the next one, which was old. So often it was the second one, it could be the third one, and if their favorite was old, we chose as well, we selected as well the next one, and we asked them a few questions about these two violins. And we asked them as well to tell us whether they think it was old or new. Plus we asked some violins that were always used were always chosen for all the players. So we had violins that were judged by all the players for new or old, and some violins were, which were depending on their choices. Because basically we wanted to see, we needed some violins which were the same for everybody, but at the same time, if these violins were violins that they had rejected from the start, they didn't have, they hadn't played much on them. So we wanted as well violins that they had played more. So it was nice as well to use violins that were among the top four to make sure that they had played a lot. And otherwise they could say, ah, oh, but I didn't play enough, I can't tell. Though normally they said that they can play instantaneously, but we didn't want to have this issue. So they usually rated between 6 and 8 violins in terms of old and new, and these are the answers. For new violins, we got 15 correct, 18 wrong, and for old violins, we got 18 correct answers and 17 wrong. So that clearly shows that they couldn't guess better than chance level. There was no obvious. So that doesn't mean that they did it by chance, and I don't think they did. They had some good explanations for why they say it was old or new, but as a result, they don't perform better than chance. There was nothing obvious that indeed soloists can tell immediately whether it's an old or new. Some people say, yeah, but you must feel it, the neck is different, and the smell, and yeah, obviously. So the only answer I can provide is obviously no, you can't feel it either. So these are some of the results for the playing part. This was published in a second paper, and now I'm going to tell you about the listening part, which hopefully should be published next month. So what about the listening point of view, and in particular for this aspect of projection, so how the violins carry at the back of the hall. So do all violins really project more, even if they seem less loud? And yeah, are they preferred as well by listeners? As I told you, there were many tests, the tests were, they were mainly designed to answer the question old and new, but not necessarily to understand a bit better this projection issue and what could differentiate the different violins. So we ran two experiments in very similar conditions. So the first one was in the same venue as the part of the listening test, the playing test. So basically, the Paris experiment I told you about was divided in 3 days. The first part in the rehearsal room, the second part in the concert hall, but without audience. And this is the third part, and an audience came and to actually judge the violins. So the interest was on the audience rather than the players. And then we did a very similar experiment in New York, a year later. The soloists were blindfolded, obviously, and they were playing behind this acoustically transparent screen I told you about. So the people in the audience couldn't see the violins either. It was quite a large audience, about 60 people in Paris, 80 in New York. 16 Paris when they started, and the experiment was actually quite long, 3 hours, so we lost a few people on our watch, but we were not so surprised. We chose for our listeners, you can't have so many violins, and so we chose to usually have like more pairs, pairwise comparison, so listeners could focus more. Because for players, they have all these tactile cues, they know what they're playing, what they're doing with the bow. So it's easier for them to, when they grab the violin, say, ah, this is the one I played just before. For listeners, it's too much, so we had to reduce the number of violins, and we decided to focus on 3 strads and 3 new violins. So pairwise comparisons, 9 pairs out of the 3 strads, 3 new, and they were repeated once. So when you, because the thing is, like, if you hear violin B after violin A, you really feel like, oh, I heard something on violin B, I would like to rehear violin A, because you would be focused on different things. So each time we heard A, B, and then A, B again. So we had A being played after B and before B. And we used 2 players to see the effect of players. Because people mentioned the projection of the violins, and nobody mentioned whether it depends on the player or not. Is it intrinsic to the violin or not? And because listeners have to hear, you know, A, B, A, B, you can't have too long excerpts, otherwise you get completely lost, and then when you hear the third one, you don't remember the first two. So we kept it short, 10 seconds for solo excerpts, and we use an orchestra as well, so the violins were tested against an orchestra, and in that case we used a bit longer to really have enough of the violin going over or not over the orchestra, so 20 seconds. The excerpts were different for the two players, so we can't distinguish the effect of the player and the excerpt. But that was the price to pay for listeners not getting bored to death by hearing always the same. So, because you, I will show you the video only for very short excerpt, and you will see it's already very, very tiring. So if you hear too much, it would just be dreadful. So the solo excerpts were chosen to actually cover the full range of the violin in 10 seconds, going from the bottom note, the G string, to the E string. And the excerpts with the orchestra were chosen a bit similarly to what we chose for with piano, was designed to, it was its famous part where the violin is really struggling to be heard over the orchestra. So we wanted to see whether some violin would be heard better than others. And so the task was to weigh the difference in terms of projection and preference between the two violins of each pair. So a relative judgment. So this was in Paris, so people were sitting at the back of the audience, and you can see the screen. And you can see little lights, that was the lights of the orchestra, because the orchestra had to see their music and the conductor. At the same time, we couldn't put in light, big light, otherwise the player would start seeing the violin. So it was a trade-off. It was a bit difficult because we had never been able to actually rehearse in this condition. So we did rehearse, but not this condition. And so we realized in the morning that the light was not enough for the orchestra musician, but at the same time we couldn't really create. So there was a bit last-minute rush. So we did start the experiment probably an hour late because of this. But at the point, we were really happy to have the hall for free for 2 days, and we couldn't really have it for more than this, so. And a bit of a video to show you. Which pair is it? Which one is played? AB of the pair, and then we change the pair and we go to the next pair solo, and she will play AB, AB, and so on. Just play maybe the first one solo. It was a bit more dramatic with a very nice shade on the screen, because what actually happened is the main TV in Japan, which is called NHK, wanted to have to make a big documentary on violin making, and especially contemporary violin making. And they had heard about my studies, so they wanted to design a blind test, and so they actually contacted me and invited me to run it. and because they wanted to make a documentary out of it, they did everything big. So I think for just that part, they actually spent half of their budget, which was amazing for me because then I had a big crew of 10 people working for me, getting, you know, all the audience sheets, giving them. It was just such a big difference because in Paris, to make it cheap, I basically did everything myself. After 3 weeks of sleep deprivation, it was a nightmare. So there, and they had all these talkie-walkie and talking, it was amazing. And they were really respectful, as I said. So basically, I designed it in two parts. The first part was supposed to be scientific, and they were not allowed to go behind the screen, and I accepted it. I said, I don't want you to know which ones I use, and because obviously, don't try to blackmail me, it will not work. I will not tell you which ones I use, so it's all confidential. So I didn't want anyone to be behind stage, not to have any leaks here. And they did respect this, and so they said, okay. So it was great because basically they offered me to redo the experiment in Paris with different volumes for basically for free. And then I organized the second part, which was more of a show for them. And so it was really kind of them. And actually, too, it may look a bit, yeah, silly to have this shadow, but it makes a difference for people to actually stay concentrated because at least you have something to watch. So, yes, you see the player, and in this particular case you had a female and a male. I don't know to which extent it may influence, but at least you see something and it's a bit easier because it's a tedious task to actually write all these pairs. So I'm sure it did help to have a bit of entertainment to some extent. So how did we ask them to judge? So in Paris, because we knew we would have roughly 50 people. We couldn't really divide the audience in groups because otherwise we would have groups of too small size and then we can't really do any statistics. So we asked them the same question, which was, you know, what is the relative projection? And that was the scale they had to use. So obviously if you put your cross in the middle, that means A and B were equal in projection. If you put it here, it was A, bigger in projection, and the more you put it, it was more A was superior in projection on this side B. So this scale allows us to have which one projects more, and as well to which extent. So it's a bit more quantitative than just saying A or B. And we didn't want to trick them or anything, so they knew from the start that they would hear the pair solo and then with orchestra. It was a question we had with, like, we should do it or not. We thought if we don't tell them, they will spend their time wondering, is that the same pair? Am I getting cheated? Will I answer the same? And you lose basically the cognitive energy. Instead of them concentrating on the task, they will lose some energy for concentrating on other questions. And at the same time, it was interesting as well for us to see whether if they know, will they actually give the same answer or not? Because it's quite possible that the same pair could be judged very differently with orchestra or not, and this is something we wanted to investigate as well. So we decided to tell them that it was the same pair and that they were allowed to change their mind, or not change their mind, but actually give just different answers. In New York, it was a big event. We knew there would be more people, so we actually arbitrarily divided them in two groups of about 40 listeners each. And so one group had to write projection for the first soloist and then preference for the second soloist. And the other group did the opposite. Because we can't ask two questions at the same time. First, because it was far too much, it was too difficult already. Answer one question was difficult. Plus, when you ask two questions, it's quite likely that the results will be correlated, just because you can't really separate the two questions, so you just answer the same. So we had to do it in two tasks. So it was the same scale, so either superior meant more projecting or superior meant preferred. It was the same way of operating. And for preferred, they had to explain as well why they preferred the one they decided to. So give you some results. The new values project more than the old ones. So this is basically the same scale as before. We called it between 1 and 1, so that would be A projecting more, B projection mode, and here we put everything so A would be old and B would be new. So obviously during the experiment, A and B could be either old and new, but here we just put them so having the old on one side, the new one. And we see that all the crosses and even the error bearers, except for this one, for this player, is on this side. And if we look at in terms of probability, the probability that there is a true effect, or a real effect of new projecting more than old by 0.2 on a scale from 0 to 1 is 95%. And 0.2 is quite large effect. So we see a big effect of new violins projecting more than old ones. These are the results for New York, and we got actually extremely similar results for Paris. It was not 0.24, but 0.23, but same probability with different violins and different people and a different concert hall. So our study seems to be quite robust in terms of choice of violins and concert hall. What about preference? Because some people say, yeah, but they can project more, but actually be too harsh and too shrilling and not be liked. Well, preference is the same. New violins are preferred. And we have the same type of effect. Just put some, the crosses are basically the answers of the player. I ask as well the players, which one did you prefer? For the players, obviously, it was too difficult to ask them to put a cross on the scale, especially if they had to concentrate on playing with the violin the same way. And like, so they just had to tell me if they preferred A or B with their fingers, which was something easy. And so it's either basically one or, the, or minus one. You can see that for this one, it's the same as the audience. For these two, not. But everything else is the same as the audience. So in terms of preference, the players, the listeners preferred the violins that were preferred as well by the players. Which is not so surprising, because you can easily imagine that to some extent, if the player likes it better, it's probably because he feels a bit more at ease. And it's something that the listeners can probably feel as well in the way they are played. I'm not going to present the Paris result, but actually for projection it's much less true. So the what the players felt on stage in terms of how it could possibly project in the audience is not necessarily in agreement with what the audience felt, which was not surprising for us, but it's surprising for some people. Because for us, we always had this problem of understanding how possibly players, by hearing the violin under their ear, could imagine how it sounded at the back of the hall. So it's not so surprising that there is more disagreement. There is still some agreement, so it seems that there is something that helps players to have an idea, but they definitely need to retest it with a friend. So their practice of usually taking a friend along and asking them to sit at the back of the hall is a good practice, and they should definitely do that, because there could be some discrepancy on what is heard on stage and what is heard on at the back. Something as well that I haven't put on my slide, but I can tell you, is the fact that in the Paris experiment, we had asked the players to actually weigh the violins in terms of loudness and estimated projection individually. And all the violins that they found were what they thought were loud and probably projecting were indeed considered as projecting by the audience. So we haven't found any evidence of a quiet violin which would magically be projecting. So if some people have a strand which does this, I'm happy to test it, but there is no clear evidence from what we have tested so far that this is possible. So it seems that there was a correlation between loudness perceived by the player under the ear and how well it projects into the back of the board. But I've done a lot of experiments since then that still need to be processed, which should shed more light on this issue. Now, we ask as well, it was a bit more for fun, because I think the listeners wanted that as well, old or new. So that was the last part of the experiment at the end, where we had seven musicians who played a long excerpt of 3 minutes. So it was actually to please the soloists, so they could really show off. It was to please the orchestra, so they could really play with the soloists and not just 10 seconds. And so we decided to make them play on their own violins, because always this argument, people think, you know, I mean, is it people have to know their violin, because otherwise they will, you know, Stradivarius are so hard to play, if they are not used to it, then they will not play them well, and then you can't recognize it's a Strad. So the seven soloists were playing either old or new violins, basically half-half, and so we were sure that there would be no problem because they had played this instrument for a long time. We had 39 listeners providing 7 guesses out of the 46, so we discarded the other 7 listeners. And we obtained that 44.7 correct answers, which were distributed, as you could expect, as a kind of a Gaussian shape. With yes, indeed, somebody managed to give 7 correct answers, but there were some 2 people gave 0 correct answers. And that's what you could expect statistically on the random samples. So no evidence that listeners can't tell them apart. And the funny thing is actually that for 5 instruments, if we look at the interval, confidence interval, they already include the 50%. So basically just people were around chance. But for 2 instruments, we got an effect of people being clearly wrong. So some people mistook a new violin for an old one, and then another violin which was old was mistaken as a new one by almost anybody. So for 5 violins it was basically 50-50, and for 2 violins we had people agreeing but on the wrong choice. So this part is going to be published in PNAS. We just have a few minor typos to correct for the revision, so it will probably make some noise again. But the previous part, which was about the playing part of the PI supplement, was published a couple of years ago now, and the criticism were actually much much less vivid at that time compared to the Indianapolis experiment. And I think the reason, because yes, obviously it was better designed, just because we had more opportunity to make it better with having more instruments and more players, and so the publicity of the first one already helped to create a better experiment. And that's the first reason. I think the second reason is because mentalities are already moving forward, and people a bit more ready to believe the evidence. But still, there are still many skeptics, even players who took part in the experiment and who actually chose a new one, didn't manage to tear them apart, and still write in the press, but what needs a new one is to be played for 200 years. But if this was the case, then they should have been able to tear them apart, and they didn't. So why does this belief that all Italian violin pertain, even if there is clear evidence that it's not the case, at least with the violins that we tested? So I'm not saying that we can't find a trial that maybe will go and be out-preferred compared to any new violins, but I haven't found it yet. So why? It can be explained by the fact that perception is not stimuli-driven, but actually expectation-driven. And that's what we call top-down processes. So what you actually perceive is not based on what you hear or see, but based on what you think you are seeing, or you know about what you're seeing or hearing, or doesn't matter, it works for any perception. So I have an example. It works well for French, but I think you may read enough. It's similar enough to English that you may understand what's happening here. It's a real headline. So Libération is one of the top 3 common journals in France, and that was a real headline. And you know that the headline of a journal is checked by quite a few people before it actually gets to be printed. And I don't know if you can see what is wrong there. maybe difficult for, because already French people are difficult to spot it. Charlotte, have you spotted it? The eye is missing of Italy, yes. But I've done the test in different audiences, and sometimes you have people for a few minutes before saying, ah, I found it. And why? It's because with mafia, you know where you are, you know? So you see something which is close enough to be Italy. In top of that, we have this in French. We kind of hide that the eye is missing. And then it went through the press, you know, without people noticing it. And so you have enough information from the start with mafia to actually not need to read everything in detail to know what it's going to be about. It's the same with this. What do you see? You see two triangles, yes? If you don't see that, then I want to study you because I haven't found it. So usually people will say there is this gray triangle which is on top of the black triangle, because it can't be in real life that you have just by chance three Pac-Men with three little arrows, three half triangles being there exactly on the shape. So you can't prevent yourself from seeing a gray triangle kind of masking some of the picture. And the funny thing, and I think it's what's important, is even if you know there is nothing, no line, you know there is no triangle, you can't prevent yourself from seeing it. So it's something that you can't shut off. It's a phenomenon that just happens, even if you know it will happen. And so what actually happens is that expectations overtune the neural circuits and cause firing patterns which are consistent with what people report perceiving, seeing or hearing, rather than what they are actually being presented. And so in the case of the strats, it could be that simply knowing the pedigree of the instrument could activate expectations that will make you hear it differently than it actually sounds. And so when people say, but I hear it, it's different, they're right. I mean, that's what they perceive. There is no doubt that they can perceive this. But it's not due to what they actually hear. There is no difference in the acoustical signal, I would say. It's because of what they know. And as I told you, you can't shut it off. So the only way to shut it off is not knowing. And so it's by doing blind tests. And so all the makers or players will tell me, but I've done the test, I just close my eyes, and I just don't look. No, it doesn't work, because usually you know. And just there is just no way you can prevent it from happening if you have the little hint that this instrument may be a strat. So you really have to do it blindfolded to shut this effect off. And so when people say, yes, they are still convinced that they sound better, well, they're convinced because they perceive them better, and that they are true. But it doesn't mean that it's because of the acoustical properties of the strats. But I mean, you probably have that for, not necessarily for in that case, but you all have experienced that when you see something old, especially in our culture, we are used to old things, we always are more attracted by old things, and there are many examples that somebody who told me, a journalist who told me that he went to the big national library in France, and he was talking to a curator who said, do you want to see an original manuscript from Mozart? And I said, of course I want to, you know. And the guy get out a very old parchment and showed it, and he told me, I was like this, amazing. And then suddenly the curator said, anyway, you don't think I could show you this, you know, that's just a fake one. And then suddenly it was fake and it was all gone. But so we are attracted in our society for old things because they have a new story, and especially these instruments, if they have survived 300 years, it's because they have been cared well, and so played usually by famous players, and then all this heritage is going to the player, and you can't make abstraction. And one of the person in the team has seen quite a lot of strides, probably 50 or 60, And he said, you know, even if he has done this test, he said, I can't prevent myself. You know, I know if it's a Strad, I will definitely look at it differently and play it differently, just because he knows it and he can't. You can't prevent it. Now, what am I in terms of time? Okay, so that's true. Okay. Just because I said we do that in the talk, present a bit the link with what we are trying to do now is, can we find any objective parameters in the measurement we have done on these violins that could explain the perception? So basically we have the constitutive liberation on one side and we have some measurements. So these measurements are done as what we call validation measurements. So we basically replace the player by a little hammer. So you can imagine that makes a lot of shortcuts and limit and simplifications, but it's the first rule. And we actually measure with the microphone what gets out of it. And we measure by turning the violins around to have an idea of what is the sound that is radiated by the instrument when excited by a impact hammer. Obviously, we don't talk to the dealers and owners that it's an impact hammer, we talk it's a little excitation device, less. We tell them as well that obviously the violin is designed to produce a lot of sound, so even if you hit it very slightly, you get a lot of sound, so they shouldn't be too scared about their violin to be damaged. And the good thing as well is the bridge is fine because there is no varnish on it or anything, so it's a convenient place to hit. And then we get curves, which we call spectra. So they are basically, you have to see that it's a response as a function of the frequency. So a violin is not like a loudspeaker, it's not designed to be flat over the frequency. We have some notes for which the radiation is bigger, some notes for which it's less. And the only thing you have to understand is if it's a peak, that means that the acoustic output will be bigger. So the higher this curve is, the more output there is, independently on how it is played. And so because we were interested in this projection and loudness, we started with this simple thing is, if we compare the sound radiation spectra from the new or the favorite instruments, are they higher than for the other instruments, because maybe they're higher because they are just louder, and for soloists it's important because they want to be heard. So here we have, so these spectra, if you just look at them, you see it's very moving a lot, it's not easy to see. Just to let you know that this is what in industry, they would just consider that's exactly the same repetition of the same thing. Okay, so that would be 20 cars. In a way, that's what they are. They are 20 violins. What resembles more violins than another violin? And we are talking about very slight differences if you think about other fields compared to industry. But these tiny differences are massive for musicians, but still we have to think that they are very tiny. And that's what makes the job very difficult, is we are going to look at tiny differences and we are trying to see how these tiny differences can explain the big perceptual differences. But in music, 5%, which is usually considered as completely fine in industry, in music, 5% is a semitone. So as you know, it's huge. So that's what makes this correlation in particular so difficult. So because they are very dramatic in terms of peaks and troughs, and we actually do some smoothing of the curves to see a bit better what's happening. So these are the smooth curves in red for the 6 most preferred, which were 3 new and 3 old. And in green, the 6 least preferred. And we can see that the red curve is basically everywhere over the green curve. So they seem that indeed the total output of the instrument seems to play a role in what players like. And now if we move to the top, the 3 most preferred against the 3 least preferred, we can see that in many places this difference is even bigger. And it's getting bigger and bigger if we move to the 2 most preferred and 2 least preferred and the most preferred and the least preferred. So investigating a bit more how this total output and how it spreads over the full frequency seems a promising direction to go further to try to understand what how we could basically explain why some violins seem more preferred, at least for from a soloist point of view. I'm not talking about another audience, because it's another type of player, because it could be quite different for orchestra players. We look as well, we can as well actually just resume, summary this curve by one unit, which would be the total, average total output, which we actually looked for different violins that we had in the Paris experiment. So on top we have N5, N11, N10, 06, 04, and so on. So these were the violins that were actually used, but we have other violins that, so in red, there was a 6 most preferred, in burgundy, the 6 least preferred. In yellow, we have the soloist's own violins that we managed to measure as well. The purple, we had the one that we didn't select during the pre-selection. And as you can see, they're quite low in terms of total output, especially some. Not at least at the top, and that's probably a reason why we didn't select them, especially we had this idea that you would do this projecting test. So we were probably sensitive to that. And then white ones were lesser old Italians that we in the end didn't consider, because we had so many strides and dangers that we thought it's no point of using them for that experiment at least. And the one which was preferred is by far above the others. So, and everybody said that was amazing with this violin, it was really powerful and loud, and at the same time having a great sound, because that's a bit what people claim, is that new violins, they are loud, but usually as in a trade-off of the sound quality, which we haven't observed, and particularly with this violin, where people always say it's loud and beautiful in terms of sound. If you look at the 10, among the 10 top in terms of output, there are 3 old and 2 new among the 10, and among the 10 bottom one, we have only 2 new and 8 old. So there is a clearly new vines have more output as well than the old one, and that could probably, it's quite likely to justify this higher projection, but that needs more investigation. Now, and that's what we see if we do. If we do all new and all old, we can see that there are some, in some places where actually the old do go over the new, but there are some white species in the middle and here where the new go over. So it's not so simple between new and old. And so it's maybe it's desirable that the sound output is bigger in some areas, but not necessarily over the whole spectrum. The thing is, some of these consistent trends that we can see, Joseph Curtin was interested to see whether it's due to some particular aspect of making the violins. So the fact you have this bump here, the difference in frequency in the trough. And his hypothesis is the fact that the old violins are too thin now, because the wood has been damaged, there's some repairs, they have to remove some wood which was damaged underneath, and so he thought that maybe the top plate especially is too thin, and so will vibrate less efficiency. And so he actually designed an experiment where he made a violin where he thinned the top progressively and measured it at different stages to see whether it could reproduce the differences that we can see between new and old violins. So that's in a way that this violin, before any, the basically the violin that you would do normally, and then he started thinning the top, and after is a green curve, and you can see the bump coming. Then he did it, I think that with another violin, and he reproduced that again, a shift downwards here, and the bump going up. And he did it a third time and got the same again. So that's another direction we want to investigate, is this difference in some of the making, or in that case it's not the making, it's just it happened because the vines have aged and you know some repairs and everything could result in this effect that seems actually not, seems detrimental to the violin, despite what players say. So, conclusions. Stradivarius, what it means, what is reality? I think our results speak by themselves. There is a clear preference for new violins and an inability of players to actually tell them apart, to separate old from new violins. That's good news and liberation for makers. So a few makers have told me that they feel liberated now because they don't feel obliged to copy Stradivarius anymore. So they can start making their own design, even if they would never go completely crazy and fancy, but still at least they can make some intermediate design between different models without feeling like I need to copy Stradivarius because that's how I'm going to make a good, the best one, basically. There is already a change in mentality that only seems that in the last couple of years of especially young makers, even at the beginning they didn't believe it, and I said, but if you don't even believe it, if you don't believe it, who is going to believe it for you, you know? So, and now they are like, yes, we should go, so makers are changing, and players as well, and makers actually told me that they can feel that with their clients. Some clients said, hey, I've read this study, do you actually make new violins? Because there are many players who play old violins who just go to the maker to actually have their violins adjusted and restored or repaired, you know. They don't necessarily know anything about making and not necessarily interested. And now apparently the people with some interest are more interested in trying new instruments. And so that's good. And of course it's good news for the young soloists, because until now they really needed a strat to make a career, and now hopefully we can hope that they will make a career for what, how they play rather than what they play. But there are still many stages before this happens, because if you look at the program, it's always written, he plays this strat, he plays that. Well, often he actually doesn't even play it on stage, but it's prestigious. And I know somebody who actually played in two parts of my experiment, that really changed his mind, and he said just a few months later he actually got an offer of a strat. And the experiment had made him think, and when he got the strat, I realized it was a crappy strat. He said, no, I don't want to play this strat, I'm going to play less well than my own violin, so what's the point? Well, the point would be that he could have been invited to the famous venues in Paris to play, and now he's not invited because he doesn't play a strat. But he deliberately chose that because he said, I want to play an instrument that I like. So it's moving, but there still need to be some progress, especially from concert programmers and benefactors. But at least it will be probably easier for violinists to find a good instrument and be respected, even if they play a new instrument. But it's not just concert programmers, even for big international competitions. So the Queen Elizabeth is one of the famous ones in Brussels. When you actually register, you have to say what is the maker who made your instrument and what is the name of your instrument. And to be honest, only strats have a name. You know, the new makers that don't necessarily give a name, they just put the year or maybe a number. But the strats, because they were played by these famous people or owned by these famous people, they usually have the name of the most influential owner at some point. So by asking them the name, that really gives a focus that they should have a strat or the Jesu. And it's time that this gets discarded. So new stories that just need to close their eyes and open their ears to find the violin that they like. Thank you very much.
Talk. What was the age range of the new Did you want to say that on this day?
No, actually I didn't. It's a good question. Some of them were just brand new, never been played at all. The oldest may have been 10 years old or...
No more than that?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. When were the new instruments made? And who made that any private?
When they were made?
No, where?
Everywhere in the world. Okay. We managed to have some from different countries.
And the M5 one.
I told you, you can blackmail me. The young soloist I told you about, he actually called me 2 years after the experiment. He said, I'm sorry to call you again, but I can't sleep since this experiment because he was in love with M5.
Yeah.
And he said, I need to find this violin. I said, but anyway, it's not on sale anymore. It was actually sold before the experiment. And he said, but you have to tell me who it is. And he was ready to give me a 50,000 euros check. He said, if I keep it secret, I keep this check, if I let people know and you hear that I've told people, you cash the check. And of course, I don't want you to cash the check. I said, I can't. And another one wanted to send me his attorney, and I wanted to sign a contract and everything. I said, no, it's not. I mean, it's a scientific study. It's not designed to be for marketing. Good makers, they are now makers who sell very high price. I mean, nothing compared to Stradivarius, but still, you know, in the range of 40,000 euros a violin, which is still quite a lot for a new violin. They're doing great. They don't need advertisement. And the players just go anywhere, try blindfolded. You will find something you like. There is no doubt about that. There are plenty available. But I think players should focus as well on new instrument rather than trying finally to get something which is all Italian but not necessarily so famous, and there will be 300,000 euros for something which is really not worth it.
The very first question you put up was do violins need playing in?
Obviously not, because some of the violins were just made finished the day before the experiment. Nobody told me. And even Hugo Borsarello, he said, no, but we have to select violins which are at least a few years old. And I said, well, if during the pre-selection you can tell me them apart, fine, I take your point. If you can't tell me that they have never been played, I don't see why.
So even amongst the new instruments, you couldn't tell. Are you aware of an experiment in New South Wales?
Yeah, I know, but they didn't show an effect either.
No, that was actually...
The ones that need repeating,
yeah.
Yeah,
and it's not really done for
so they didn't show anything either. Even the player who owned one of the violins and played it for 2 years, he couldn't tell them, he couldn't tell his violin already apart from the one which stayed in the museum for 2 years. He did manage that 70%. Still 30% wrong.
Yeah.
So there's nothing obvious there. Now, makers will agree that a violin changes the first year. There is no doubt about this. Usually for the worst, when they are very honest about it. And that's why they always ask the players to come back regularly. Why? Because basically when the violin is made and you have all these constraints, you have to know that the tension of the string on the bridge is basically a pack of Evian 6 bottles. So it's a lot. And so all this tension and pressure will actually modify the violin. You know, plus the violin is put in the vibration, the molecule of water inside will move, the glue will dry even more over the course of a few months, the varnish and everything, so it does change. And it's quite famous, and it's really well known that the sound force has to be adjusted quite a lot throughout the first year because it gets too short. And the violin does change, but it doesn't change in a way that it will improve, apparently, even worse. And
you say it's well known. Where is this information? So
when I say well known, it's makers know. I mean, makers who deliver a new violin, they always tell their client, please come back in 3 months, because they have to adjust a new sound post and have to make sure that the bridge hasn't, maybe make a longer bridge, or they know they have to change a bit the violin to go back to the initial condition because of the static pressure and things like this. But what Joseph Curtin told me, he felt like each time that the client comes back, so after 3 months, each time the client said, "Oh, your violin has opened up, and I'm so happy." And he listened to it and he said, "Sounds crap." Because the tension is on the soundpost is not good anymore. So what has happened is the player has started learning how to play on that violin, has adjusted his way of playing. So for him, the violin has become better. But it's probably the player who actually knows how to play better that instrument rather than the violin becoming better. Because for Joseph, he said, for me, it was always something less good as what he had remembered. Yeah. And for good reasons, because he needed to adjust a new sound post, so often change the bridge as well. So
if I own the violin and lend it to somebody else to play on a regular basis and then get it back, then I should expect it to be come back not sounding as good, depending on if it's not been maintained in the meantime.
I know that some players told me this story, that they let it to someone, they got it back and they said, "It's not my violin anymore." It's something I would love to investigate, but I haven't found a good, satisfying way to do it on a scientific basis, because basically you would have somebody who accept to leave his violin for 3 months, somebody who accept to play it slowly, every day, and hopefully blindfolded, so you know, I mean, there are so many things that... possible, but I mean, there is no evidence about that. It doesn't mean that there is no evidence that it doesn't happen, but we haven't found a good way to study it. At least for a given mind that it really opens up and it does change. We know it changes this time, that's for sure, because it's wood. And it's more than wood, it's a complex structure which we modify. To the extent that a player can't recognize it's his violin, I'm skeptical, but at the same time, I've heard it a few times. But at the same time, I've heard it so many times as well that strats were better, you know. So.
Can we have one or two quick questions, if that's okay, then we'll wrap up? Yes, you have your hand up for a while.
I'm just wondering if. Say we did start believing, everyone starts believing that strats do not sound, necessarily sound better than new violins. Do you think they'd still be really valuable just because they're really old, or that because certain like famous solos have played them?
Oh yeah, but then we are in what we are in the field of art, but not in the field of an acoustical tool. So what I'm saying is based on as an acoustical tool for a musician, they're not better. Now, it's a beautiful piece of art, and then if people are ready to pay, you know, millions to have a real compared to a copy, it's the same as if you prefer to have a real Picasso compared to a copy. Nobody will see the difference, I mean, I suppose. Most of us will not see it, and it will not be the same price, obviously. So, it's this is a question of how you want to benefit from this input. And we know that the main effect is knowing that it's a Strad and that has been played by amazing players. If it makes you play better and you're ready to pay millions for this, go. But people should be aware that they don't need to pay this to actually play, in terms of acoustics, as good on other.
The graph that you showed is that showed a slight difference in the resonance of different frequencies.
Yeah.
So it caught my eye because the two main bumps in the mid-range were consistently at a slightly lower frequency in the older instruments. Perhaps to do the pitch being lower at the time that they were made. The pitch has risen, and so they were designed to resonate at different...
No, because when they were designed to resonate at 415, they were not set up like this. They had a different neck. Yes, that's something I didn't mention when I talk about Stradivarius. It's a Stradivarius as it is now, which is completely different from the Stradivarius as it was built by Stradivarius. The only Stradivarius which is still in its original state is...
It's in the UK,
no?
It's the Messiah. The Messiah violin.
Is it the Messiah?
Isn't the one at the Ashmolean?
I think the Masaya still has a new neck, no? I think it's another one. Or maybe, okay, anyway, I mean, there is still one in the world, and I think it's in the UK. But obviously it would be completely unplayable. But all the other Stradivarius have been completely modified to fit with the new aesthetic. So the, so basically what we call Stradivarius is the box. The bridge is new, the strings are new, the neck is new, the angle of the neck has changed. And so everything has been done when there was a new tuning, so that wouldn't explain. And obviously the resonance of the box would be very different with a different neck and a different bridge setup and different sound post as well. So.
But still the box itself was designed
by Stradivarius.
At the time when...
Yes, but the resonances of the box is the resonance that I show is the full instrument. And so the influence of the bridge is huge on this, on what you can see. The influence of the sound post is big, the influence of the neck is less big but still, so we can't say that it's because of that.
And just very quickly, can we get this presentation from you?
I will share it when the last paper is published, so next month, okay? I know that CNRS is very strict on embargoes and everything, so they don't want any problem with it, so I can share it when it's published.
Once it's published, if Claudia is willing, we'll certainly host it on the website, but that's for Claudia's to say.
So probably in a month.
Well, thank you very much, I think, for this.